Ladies and gentlemen, I am Cliff Riley from the Scientific Research Council, and welcome and thank you for joining us for the 12th scientific session. During this session, we'll be discussing two very important matters which we tend to shy away from, primarily physical activity and diet. We also expect two very interesting presentations, one from Dr. Lauriann Young-Martin, as well as another from Dr. Rohan Wilks. At this point, we will start with introduction of our speakers and ask again that our delegates take their seats as soon as possible. Well, Dr. Young-Martin is no stranger to us. She obtained her MPhil and her PhD degrees from the University of Western Mona. She is currently a senior lecturer and the head of the Physiology Department at the University of the West Indies. And she also received training as a visiting scientist at Howard University in Washington, D.C., Morris School of Medicine in Atlanta, and the University of Illinois School of Medicine at Rockford, among others. Her research interest focuses on the impact of stressors, gender, and neuroendocrine regulatory mechanisms on drug-seeking behavior, being addiction, learning and memory in forms of cognition, and other behavioral paradigms, including anxiety using animal models. Dr. Young-Martin has played a major role in the training of quite a number of our clinicians and other students going through the Department of Basic Medical Sciences, and we warmly welcome her to deliver a presentation. Dr. Young-Martin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good afternoon, everyone. The talk is on stress physiology. I'm a physiologist, and I've been asked to do a talk on stress physiology as it relates to diabetes. And what I want to do this afternoon is just give a very quick overview of the physiological neuroendocrine regulatory pathways that respond to stress. Many of you will know this already, and some of you, is just a reminder for many of you. And also outline how stress may actually cause the development of symptoms and signs related to diabetes mellitus. And I will end by discussing very briefly whether results of studies, both human and animal studies, that are provided the data are sufficient to provide evidence to support a direct causal link between stress and diabetes. Historically, stress has always been a symptom, a part of the diagnosis, the clinical diagnosis of diabetes. And in fact, the physician Thomas Willis in the 17th century wrote in his book that stress is often observed in the clinical diagnosis of diabetes. And the role of stress in the etiology of diabetes became well established in the 19th century. But the famous physiologist canon in the early part of the 20th century doubted the clinical observations and tested the hypothesis in animal experiments. And what he did was actually stressed about 12 normal cats, and he observed by stressing them, actually infusing a lot of water into their stomach. That's what he did. And what he found was that these normal cats started to show hyperglycemic effects. They actually were hyperglycemic. And he attributed this to the flight-fright response. So what is stress? The famous Hans Selye, the physiologist, in about the same time, early 20th century, did the first set of human experiments using stress and wrote that stress is a non-specific response of the body to any demand made upon it. He further explained physiologically that it is an adaptive mechanism in which the body enters into a defense mode to restore balance. Homeostasis is a very important aspect of physiology, and this is what the body is trying to do in response to this stressor. Now, there are three phases that comprise this response. And the first phase is the alarm reaction. It usually occurs when the acute stressor is applied. And here is where homeostasis, that balance that normally exists for the full physiological balance and operation function of the body, homeostasis is actually altered to generate physiological functions that increase energy availability. And this energy availability is to meet the demands of the stress. And it may include increases in, of course, blood glucose, heart rate, and so on. Once the stress is removed, homeostasis is normally restored and balance returned. But if the stress persists, then we enter the second phase. And this is the resistance or adaptation phase. And in this phase, visceral and physical chemical parameters are altered to allow for considerable amount of energy expenditure. And this is varied, and all the speakers before have spoken about all kinds of things in terms of diabetes. And this is where different people react differently. And the resilience of the subject, the individual, is going to depend on the genetics, the cognitive and psychosocial factors. So some persons cope well, but a lot of other persons do not cope with persistent stress. If the stress persists and becomes inevitable, repetitive, unwanted, this is where we enter the phase three, where there's exhaustion of adaptability or burnout. And here, this may actually result in illness or even death. And so, when we look at the physiological responses of stress, you will know, most of you know, that in response to stress, a lot of neural and hormonal secretions are augmented. They increase in order to alter behavior. And this is to produce physical and metabolic changes that allow the individual to adapt to the stressor. So our diagram there on the right shows a man and all the various organs and glands that actually release stress hormones in response to stress. So it's a very complicated situation. So we have glands from the hypothalamus, the pituitary gland in the brain, as well as in the periphery, all sorts of thyroid, gonads, ovaries and testes, as well as the adrenal gland, the pancreas. These are all glands that release stressors, stress hormones or neurotransmitters or other kinds of substances like that, which affect a physiological change and allows the body to adapt to the stressor. Now you know that the biological systems involve in adaptation and that mediate the link between stress and the physiological functions are mainly, this, we speak of the hypothalamus pituitary adrenal axis, the HPA, the famous HPA axis. And of course, many of us will know about the autonomic nervous system. The immune system is also involved. And these are the three main areas associated with the stress response, so to speak. But it is much more complicated than that, because just about all areas of the brain are involved in some way or the other with perceiving the stress and how the body, the individual reacts to that stress, because the brain, of course, controls the systems of the body. So there are many more areas than just the HPA axis that is involved in stress centrally, or the autonomic nervous system peripherally, as well as the immune system. And I just want to point out that multiple stressors produce additive responses. So it's not just a single and you remember it and it goes when you don't. Every stress can add some more to the physiology. And eventually, if you are prone to subjected to too much stress, then systems will start breaking down. And of course, most of you will know this. This is the autonomic nervous system. This is the first response that we feel when we are frightened or stressed. The sympathetic nervous system on the right is the system that responds very quickly. That's the peripheral nervous system, and it responds to flight or fright and so on. And that sympathetic nervous system causes a lot of physiological changes to occur to enable energy mobilization to allow the individual, the animal, to flee or to fight or, you know, to do whatever it is to respond to the stress. Of course, we have the other aspect of the autonomic nervous system, which once the stress is removed, then it restores and brings back the body to a relaxed state. balances the body back, the restorative system, which is called the parasympathetic nervous system. And I just want to point out to you the splanchnic nerves and where they innervate the specific organs or glands that we are talking about, the adrenal gland, and specifically the adrenal medulla is the area of the adrenal gland that the sympathetic nervous system innervates. And of course, it also sends splanchnic nerves to the pancreas and the liver. And of course, you've heard about all the clinical consequences of that. But that sympathetic nervous system, which is a peripheral nervous system, although it operates autonomically, in other words, automatically, you have no volition, it just operates and you are frightened and you respond. That system is actually modulated by higher centers in the brain, specifically the hypothalamus. And so the hypothalamus modulates and activates the sympathetic nervous system through the spinal cord to stimulate areas like the adrenal medulla, which releases in the bloodstream, or certainly in the bloodstream, your catecholamines, norepinephrine and epinephrine, or otherwise called noradrenaline and adrenaline. But once that hypothalamus is activated, the HPA system is also activated. And this is a neuroendocrine system releasing a host of hormones that are going to produce effects. And two of the important hormones are your corticotropin-releasing hormone and your vasopressin, arginine vasopressin. And these hormones stimulate the pituitary gland, which itself releases a lot of hormones, but in particular, they cause the release of adrenocorticotropin, ACTH, which stimulates, binds to the receptors on the adrenal cortex in particular, not the adrenal medulla, no, but it's part of the adrenal gland, adrenal cortex, and causes the adrenal cortex to release things like cortisol. And these cortisol, along with the catecholamines, noradrenaline, adrenaline, produce a whole set of changes in the body, stimulating like the liver to undergo glycogenolysis, producing gluconeogenesis, lipolysis, and causing a whole series of effects or functions to adapt, to allow the individual to adapt to the stressor. Now, it's not as simple as that, because the systems actually speak to each other, and there is positive feedback between the sympathetic nervous system and the HPA system, as well as the HPA system onto the sympathetic nervous system. And when the HPA system activates the sympathetic nervous system, it also causes a release of things like interleukin-6, which will start a cytokine cascade occurring. So you see, the system is very, very interactive and complex. Now, if it was allowed to act like this all the time, then of course you were going to get burnout and you're going to get maladaptation. And so the system has a corrective measure where there is negative feedback to ensure that homeostasis or balance is returned. And it is when this system is overridden, so to speak, by too much stress, perhaps, or some other factor, that you get breakdown in homeostasis. And so we said that we were talking about the HPA system and the autonomic nervous system, but it is a much more complicated system than that when you perceive stress. So once the stressor is perceived and your brain responds to that, perceives that stressor, then various areas in the brain are activated, and eventually, of course, the hypothalamus is activated. And once the hypothalamus is activated, the autonomic nervous system is also activated. And so we see the interaction of the hypothalamus on the HPA system as well as on the sympathetic or autonomic nervous system, causing effects that are associated with all the tissues of the body, the heart, the glands of the body, the skeletal muscles, smooth muscles of the gut, and other target organs. But once that hypothalamus is activated, it not only produces its effects as well as producing its effects on the autonomic nervous system via the sympathetic nervous system, it also produces effects on other systems. And here we see that hypothalamic activation can cause, activation of cytokines, which are part of the immune response. And of course, stress, if it's a stressor, then of course you see even the circadian rhythm of the individual can be affected by activation or changes there, okay? So we see that negative feedback becomes very important in regulating the amount of hormones that are available when blood levels rise above their normal threshold. And in a situation of chronic stress, we're going to impair this negative feedback mechanism, and the resultant effect would be things like elevated cortisol levels because the feedback is not working well, elevated catecholamines like your norepinephrine, your epinephrine, your dopamine, and of course there is inflammatory markers that are also involved. And this diagram helps to illustrate that. So the feedback is not only from the onto the pituitary gland, it's also at the level of the brain to ensure that balance is restored. But if the stressor persists, then that balance can be impaired. So prolonged, persistent, chronic stress affects hormonal balance. It can affect the metabolism as a result of the hormones that are released, and it certainly will affect the immune functions. And in physiology, there's another term that helps to explain this, the allostatic load. And allostatic load, allostasis, is similar to the homeostasis, but more specific. And when we refer to the allostatic load, we are actually talking about, it's summarizing the actual cumulative impact of all the physiological wear and tear related to maladaptive stress patterns. So chronic stress may result in pathologies as a result of a high allostatic load, so things like hypercortisolism. And what do we see in that? We see high levels of cortisol, and the effects are things like altered immune function, tissue resistance to insulin, glucose intolerance. And does that sound anything like diabetes? Maybe. And diabetes, you all know, is a metabolic disease. You've heard that, you know about that. It's inability to maintain glucose, normal glucose levels, altered secretion or action of your insulin, the type 1 and type 2. Type 1, of course, is an autoimmune disease against your beta cells of the pancreas. Type 2, of course, is due maybe to insulin resistance or the inability of the cells of the pancreas to compensate adequately to insulin release. Is there a link between stress and diabetes? Well, physiologically, the stressor, as we saw, will stimulate the sympathetic nervous system. And sympathetic activation will cause increased levels of your catecholamines. And catecholamines, one of their effects is to increase glycogen breakdown in the liver, causing increased glucose circulation in the blood. And once you increase your glucose in the bloodstream, you're going to stimulate your beta cells of the pancreas to release insulin. If this stress persists, then you can understand that the beta cells will eventually burn out, and you may end up having low insulin or something like that, in addition to your high circulating levels of glucose. In addition to that, the sympathetic nervous system, through the release of your catecholamines, will stimulate other tissues in the body, and you know that these can result in things like hypertension. And it also causes lymphopenia, which results in suppressed immune response, which may lead to immunodeficiency disease. So the situation is quite complicated. But that is just at the autonomic level. And if we go back to the HPA axis, we see the release of cortisol. Cortisol is absolutely important to human survival. And cortisol, we know, has both anabolic and catabolic effects. Anabolic effects on your liver and kidneys, catabolic effects on lymphoid tissue and other kinds of tissues. Also has anti-inflammatory effects. right, among other things. In a situation of chronic stress, what happens? You expect the negative feedback is going to be impaired, and as a result of that, the elevated cortisol levels are going to cause lots of gluconeogenesis, for instance, yes, increase glucose production as a result of the breakdown of muscles and proteins in the body, for instance. This will cause elevated blood glucose because the tissues will not utilize the glucose, and the increase in levels of glucose will cause an increase in insulin secretion. This will eventually cause exhaustion of the beta cells of the pancreas, and with the high glucose levels and the tired beta cells, then you can probably get your hypoglycemia. Does this cause diabetes mellitus? Well, not sure. So in summary, cortisol depresses glucose uptake by the cells. It is actually a very poor supply of energy, and most of the energy supplied is through the breakdown of your lipids as a result of both cortisol and your catecholamines. But interestingly, what is good? It is anti-inflammatory. And so as a result of its anti-inflammatory properties, it is useful during stress to prevent overshoot of the defense mechanisms of the body. So we have our type 1 and we have our type 2 diabetes. And is stress a link, a causal, a linear cause of diabetes 1? Or diabetes 2. We know that we use our stress tests in the whole treatment and management, yes, but is stress a cause of type 1 or type 2 diabetes? And we know what type 1 diabetes results from: development of your antibodies against your pancreatic cells and autoantibodies against insulin. The reports, a review of the literature indicates that there is no direct causal link, although there is evidence to sort of suggest that there may be an association. So epidemiological studies indicate that severe stress often precedes the development of your Th1-mediated autoimmune diseases, a study done by Atan-Lokovic and others. Studies also show that psychological stress, and I don't differentiate psychological stress from physiological stress because your emotions is part of your physiology, but you know what I mean. Psychological stress in children, the study was found that there was altered antigen activity. I don't know those genes, but there was altered antigen activity, and this alteration is associated with DM-related autoimmunity. That was a study done in 2014. However, there's not sufficient, there's far more variables than that, and this is not sufficient to indicate a direct causal link. As with regards to type 2 diabetes, where there's chronic hyperglycemia, insulin resistance, impaired insulin secretion, along with all the other effects, cortisol, as we saw, is also a main contributor to the effect of these kinds of stress on metabolism in general, and on glucose metabolism in particular, and it's due to its various actions, all right? But the research shows, studies showed, and this is one good one, that there's impaired, a recent study in 2015 by Carvalho showed that there's impaired beta adrenergic pathways and blunted stress reactivity. And that supports a lot of the things that have been spoken about already. And so this is stress tests and so on would be certainly support the incidence, the etiology of that due to the impaired beta adrenergic pathways and blunted stress reactivity in diabetic patients. Longitudinal studies done previously have also shown an increased risk of developing diabetes in persons with high levels of stress. However, what they used in this study was workplace stress, and not everybody responds in the same way to workplace stress. So there are some, you know, other studies, a very nice little study that was done on non-diabetic young people. So they're young people and they watch them. These are young people diagnosed with depression, And the study showed that over time, there was an increased risk of developing diabetes. And of course, of note, studies have also reported that women are at increased risk of stress-induced type 2 diabetes. But having reviewed the literature, the association between stress and diabetes, from what I've seen, certainly in the scientific community, it remains controversial. The scientific community is still not sure, and some people say yes, and a lot of people say it's not. There are too many variables that are involved. And the insulin resistance and conditions with varying degrees of glucose intolerance are often clinically clustered as the former session as a metabolic syndrome. And many will argue that the metabolic syndrome doesn't have a clearly defined pathophysiology. And so it is not just diabetes mellitus, but there are other conditions. And so it the whole system becomes somewhat vague at times. One of the drawbacks with the studies is that there's no standardized stressor that everybody can quantitatively respond to in a specific way. And that is to show you how complex the system is. And so as a result of that, because people respond differently to different type of stressors, different studies use different type of stressors, we find that the studies don't necessarily corroborate each other, even though there may be significant findings in some of the studies that I've shown you that indicated. Studies also use subjects who are already diabetic and compared with non-diabetics. And of course, you know some of the complications of diabetes, autonomic neuropathy and stuff like that, which can impact and interfere and bias the results of the study. So in conclusion, I just wanted to say that a causal link between stress and diabetes mellitus, even though there is sometimes strong association, the data shows that it is still not yet established that it causes diabetes. There are aspects of it that can cause or precipitate in some way, trigger, but there is no direct cause link between stress and diabetes. And this is due largely to the confounding effects in the various studies, differences in study design, the forms of stressors that are used, the ascertainment of a standardized stressor, which we do not yet have. So the role of stress and depression, whilst seeming to be strong in the pathophysiology of type 2 diabetes, it still remains controversial as far as many are concerned. There is a strong association in some of the studies, but there are many other variables that need to be tested. Studies have, however, shown that psychological stress, this is emotional stress, if we go back to that, can develop following a diagnosis of diabetes. This is one study that I saw, strong correlation. But I think with any disease, when persons are told they have a disease, it does cause some emotional distress, and some persons do not recover very well from even just knowing that they have this disease. But this depression, this psychological stress can actually impact how the patient moves forward. And so, in terms of their lifestyle changes and, what they have to do in order to ensure that they keep well and fit. And so, apart from nutrition, which is a very important aspect, stress can actually worsen in some aspects, psychological stress, the progression of diabetes for some patients. And so this is something that you should also consider in terms of those patients who tend to show depressed effects, that some psychotherapy along with nutrition, along with all the other things, are actually part of the treatment and management of diabetes. So this is the end of my talk. I thank you very much.
Can we give Dr. Young Martin another round of applause? Absolutely informative presentation. Most times we think of diet and exercise and not so much about the psychological impacts of what happens in our day-to-day lives. We now move to the second presentation, looking more on exercise and diet, and this presentation will be delivered by Dr. Rohan Wilks. Dr. Wilks completed both his MBBS and his Doctor of Medicine in Internal Medicine at the University of the West Indies, and he also completed a fellowship in clinical cardiology at the University of Toronto in 2016. Currently, he works as a consultant physician in cardiology at the University, at the Kingston Public Hospital, a consultant cardiologist at Winchester Cardiology Services, and consultant cardiologist at the Heart Foundation of Jamaica. Can we please give Dr. Wilks a round of applause as he approaches?
All right, good afternoon, everyone. First, I'd like to say thanks to the organizers for inviting me to speak at this prestigious conference for the second year consecutively. When I got the invitation, I figured I didn't do too badly last year. Either that or the organizers were desperate. But a conference like this is never desperate for speakers. You know, go 25 years and have this much prestige and struggle for speakers. So thank you. And thank you to the audience for sticking around. I know it's been a long day. So we're going to be talking about diet and exercise in the management of diabetes, and with a special look at the Mediterranean diet. It's been gaining popularity in the literature and in clinical practice in some places. So other than the fact that I'm not a nutritionist, I have no other disclosures. So the objectives, we're going to try and outline the keys to optimal diabetes management and try to tie in diet and exercise with gaining these goals. We want to look at the role of dietary modification in achieving the management targets, with a specific look at the Mediterranean diet, and then outline the role of exercise in achieving these targets as well. So as I'm sure you would have heard in previous talks, you know, when we talk about diabetes management, even though glycemic control is central and still essential, we recognize diabetes, its role in metabolic syndrome and the connection with hypertension, and the importance of managing blood pressure as well. And we know that in the face of diabetes, where you have insulin resistance or insulin deficiency, not only do we have issues with controlling glycemia, but also lipid abnormalities will arise, and it's important to manage these issues to reduce the patient's cardiovascular risk, so we can reduce morbidity and mortality. So as it relates to blood pressure management, won't spend too much time here. Dr. Ferguson went through this quite nicely about the importance of reducing blood pressure, achieving targets. You know, we've had a shift where we're targeting blood pressures more in the range of 130-80 by some guidelines, but definitely less than 140/90 we should try to achieve. And a large part of this is done through pharmacotherapy, but lifestyle management is still, the foundation and very important in achieving this. So of note, in patients who are overweight or obese, weight loss is an important tool in reducing their blood pressure. The so-called DASH diet, where there's a focus on reduced sodium intake, increased potassium intake with liberal amounts of fruits and vegetables is recommended and has been shown to reduce blood pressure as well as the use of physical activity and moderation in alcohol intake. Now, I'm not sure how well this slide projects, but basically it summarizes numerically and quantitatively the effect of these different interventions on the blood pressure. You can see at the top where the effect of weight loss on systolic blood pressure, and we know that it would tend to see more of a marked change in people with hypertension as opposed to people with normal tension, and as much as a 5 millimeter mercury reduction in blood pressure just by losing weight. Additionally, a healthy diet can reduce the systolic blood pressure by 11 millimeters mercury. And as you go down the line, you see how reducing salt, moderating alcohol intake, and achieving adequate physical activity can reduce your systolic blood pressure as well. as it relates to lipid management. You know, Dr. Chung, you know, went through the guidelines and the different strategies in achieving target lipids. But in addition to, you know, all the drugs that we use, again, weight loss is indicated in people who are overweight or obese. We want to reduce the amount of saturated fat. We want to keep trans fats to a minimum. And we want to increase dietary intake of omega-3 fatty acids. Unfortunately, the literature hasn't really supported using supplementary omega-3, but certainly eating food that's rich in omega-3 is beneficial. So we know our oily fishes such as salmon, herring, etc., can help with that, as well as increased fiber in the diet and whole wheat products. So as it relates to glycemic control, as I said, this is central to the management of diabetes. We know that we have to individualize our HbA1c targets. This is a nice slide from the ADA guidelines, which it gives a good illustration of how flexible we have to build our HbA1c targets based on different parameters, you know, patients, how long they've had their disease, you know, life expectancy, different comorbidities, and whether or not we target 7% or be a little more aggressive at 6.5 or a little more lenient at 7.5 in somebody who is more elderly with less life expectancy. So nutrition therapy, we know, is again a foundation in glycemic control. Again, this is not, there's no one size fit all. You know, these patients need to have individualized meal plans, ideally under the supervision of our dietitian. And you know, the data is there to support it. We know that in people with type 1 diabetes who get medical nutrition therapy, they'll have HbA1c reductions as much as 1% just from the diet only, without factoring in any medication. And in patients with type 2 diabetes, you can have HbA1c reduction as much as 2% just from diet only. We recommend healthful eating with high nutrient dense, high quality foods. And when you look at the guidelines, they recommend Mediterranean diet, DASH diet, and as well as plant-based diets as a few options of diets that constitute healthful eating. Overall, you want to reduce caloric intake, especially if you're trying to achieve weight loss in the overweight and obese individuals. You want to individualize macronutrient distribution in terms of how much protein, how much carbohydrates and fats. Again, it's not one size fits all. You want to promote more whole grains, vegetables and fruits, high fiber and you know, foods that won't let the blood sugar spike, such as white rice and bread, etc. And of course, you know, there's been a large thrust in the media to avoid foods with added sugars, especially sugar sweetened beverages. We have to limit as much as we can or eliminate. So we're going to take a closer look at the Mediterranean diet. And of course, the Mediterranean diet describes the traditional diet consumed by the different territories surrounding the Mediterranean Sea. Now, one of the problems with you know, this diet and employing this diet is that there's a lot of heterogeneity, because as you can imagine, in this region there's regional differences, religious differences, etc. So there's no one Mediterranean diet. So you'll see in the literature they'll talk about a Mediterranean type diet. So it's kind of hard to pin down, and it makes it hard to study across different populations because there's no one set diet. But we're going to talk about, in general terms, how we try to mimic the Mediterranean diet. So the Mediterranean diet should be high in vegetables and fruits, lots of legumes and nuts and beans, as well as they use a lot of cereals, grains. We spoke about the increased amount of fish, and in particular, there's a lot of unsaturated fats, and in particular, the use of olive oil. And there's it's particularly low in meat intake and dairy as well. All right, so this slide, you know, kind of outlines the constituents of the different diets. We have the DASH diet, Mediterranean diet, and TLC diet, and kind of outlines what we just said in terms of the different compositions, in terms of a large amount of grains, fruits, vegetables in the Mediterranean diet. And one of the things that kind of strikes me with this table is that if you look at the DASH diet and the TLC diet, they're like set servings per day. The Mediterranean diet is not as stringent. It just tells you large amounts of this, less amounts of this. And I think this adds to the type of flexibility we need when we're prescribing diets for patients. So just to look at some of the data, this study was published in the Annals of Internal Medicine, September 2009, looking at the effects of a Mediterranean-style diet on the need for anti-hyperglycemic drug therapy in patients with newly diagnosed type 2 diabetes. So it was a single-center study, a randomized trial done in Italy. Of course, they had a large amount of Caucasian subjects in this population. But what they did was they looked at patients with newly diagnosed type 2 diabetes that were overweight. They didn't have an extremely high HbA1c. All of the HbA1c's was below 11. And they randomized them to two groups. One group they gave a Mediterranean-style diet. The other group they gave the low-fat diet. That's what's in most guidelines. And the primary outcome they looked at was the start of anti-hyperglycemic drug therapy. So they started them on the diet, repeated the HbA1c. If the HbA1c came below 7, then they left them off medication. If it remained above 7, then they'd start therapy. So they looked at, you know, how long can we delay these patients from needing medication for their diabetes. They also looked at some secondary outcomes of changes in weight, the glycemic control in general, and changes in any risk factors. And they followed them up for 4 years. So that's just illustrating the randomization. This is the baseline characteristic showing that the randomization was equal in all the important parameters. And this shows the primary outcome, looking at the probability of remaining free of anti-hyperglycemic drug therapy. And you can see the Mediterranean diet in the darker line, a larger proportion of the subjects would remain free of needing drug therapy compared to the usual low-fat diet. Another study looking at the effects of the Mediterranean-style diet specifically on cardiovascular risk factors was done in July 2006. This was a larger study. It's a multi-center randomized trial. This particular analysis was actually looking at the running phase of a larger PREDIMED trial where it was done at 10 hospitals across Spain, adults 55 to 80 years with type 2 diabetes and or they had three or more risk factors. So these were patients at high risk. And they were randomized to either the usual low-fat diet or a Mediterranean-style diet with added virgin oil or a Mediterranean-style diet with added mixed nuts. And when they looked at the comparison of the both Mediterranean diets with low-fat diet, there was a significant reduction in systolic blood pressure and increase in HDL cholesterol, but they didn't really see a reduction in LDL cholesterol, and there was no significant change in weight. Additionally, a meta-analysis of 17 studies was done looking at the Mediterranean diet, and overall it showed where the diet was effective in preventing type 2 diabetes, as was shown by the first study, improving glycemic control in type 2 diabetes, and also improve cardiovascular risk. Now to take a quick look at exercise, we know that physiologically, we know there are some acute effects of exercise that can be beneficial. There's increased glucose uptake by the muscles as aerobic oxidation takes place. It can improve systemic insulin action and increase fat oxidation as anaerobic oxidation takes place. in terms of the chronic effects of exercise, you can increase muscle mass, increase your basal metabolic rate. You do get a small reduction in the LDL with chronic exercise, a small reduction in systolic blood pressure, and reduce all-cause and cardiovascular mortality. It does help produce weight loss, as we showed in one of the earlier slides. Also reduces symptoms of depression and improves quality of life in studies that they did quality of life scoring on. So the current recommendations for exercise, you know, 150 minutes per week of moderate to vigorous aerobic exercise at least 3 days of the week. And they shouldn't really have a break of more than 2 days between exercise sessions. And in addition to aerobic exercise, there's also strong recommendation for vigorous resistance training 2 to 3 days in addition to the aerobic exercise. Now, not all the data has been very impressive. We'll take a look back at this study done by the Look Ahead Research Group, published in the New England Journal of Medicine, looking at the cardiovascular effects of intensive lifestyle intervention in type 2 diabetes. Now, this was another multi-center trial, again, looking at adults with type 2 diabetes who were overweight. And they randomized them into two groups, one undergoing intensive lifestyle intervention, and another with just usual diabetes support and education and allowing them to institute their lifestyle changes on their own. In the intervention group, they got a strict 1,200 to 1,800 kilocalorie per day diet, again, with low in fat, and they ensured that they had more than 15% of their calories from protein. And they had more than the recommended amount of exercise, and they had 175 minutes of moderate intensity exercise per week. And the primary outcome was to look at the first occurrence of a composite of cardiovascular outcomes, which we'll outline soon. And they followed them up for almost 10 years. 9.6 was the mean follow-up. Again, equal characteristics in the two randomization groups. Now, when they looked at the effect of weight, physical fitness, waist circumference, and HbA1c, there was positive effects across the board for the intensive lifestyle modification group. However, when they looked at the outcome in terms of cardiovascular outcomes, they had a composite of non-fatal MI, non-fatal stroke, or hospitalization for angina, there's no statistical difference between the two groups. You know, one of the limitations of this study is, you know, some people are of the opinion that if we did this intensive lifestyle change for a longer period, we would see the cardiovascular benefit. Again, this was only 9.6 years. So maybe with a longer study period, we'd see more of a cardiovascular benefit, as we did see the changes in the weight, HbA1c, etc., over that period. Additionally, you know, when we look at a Cochrane review, there's one study that actually looked at diet versus physical activity kind of head-to-head. There's no statistically significant difference between the two. They're able to, you know, reduce the development of diabetes in either group. And when you look at all the studies that have been done, the combination of physical activity and diet is of definite benefit. So just to summarize, as I said, diabetes entails glycemic control along with blood pressure control and lipid management. Lifestyle modification remains an integral tool in achieving treatment goals. The Mediterranean style diet has clear benefit in terms of, you know, preventing diabetes, delaying the need for anti-hyperglycemic medication, and improving cardiovascular risk factors. Diet has been shown to have a slightly larger impact on achieving outcomes where compared to exercise, but definitely best is to use them in combination. All right, so thanks for your attention. That's the end of the presentation.
Thank you very much, Dr. Wilks. Can we give him another round of applause? Time is very, very short on us, so we're going to just ask for two quick burning questions. Just two, we can't go beyond that. Do we have any burning questions from the audience? One at the back, and the last one here. So those are our two questions. Please, you can go ahead, ma'am. Yes, please.
Thanks. Good evening. Thank you for excellent presentations. Quickly, the Mediterranean diet. I live in the Caribbean. And although you have explained more or less what it is, what really should we be telling our patients and ourselves and other persons who want to prevent diabetes and probably have a family history, have risk?
Okay. Yeah, that's a good question. You know, application to our population is essential. You know, as I said, the heterogeneity of the Mediterranean diet makes it a little difficult. When you look at a lot of studies, what they tend to focus on in terms of a parameter to look at how close the diet is to a Mediterranean style diet is looking at the carbohydrate component of the diet. Even though you want to individualize, you know, low carbs is a big part of the Mediterranean diet. I think in a lot of the studies they ensure that the carbohydrate contribution to daily calorie intake was less than 50%. So that's a nice guide to use. Another good guide to use is, especially for, you know, patients who are more tech savvy, is to use the calorie counting apps like MyFitnessPal, etc. And that's a good way that they can plug in what food they eat, and it tells them how much carbohydrate is in it, how much protein is in it, how much fat's in it. And that's a good way for them to learn to track their calories and the constituents of what they're eating and try to achieve weight loss. But definitely reducing the overall amount of calories and the low carbohydrate diet is a basic message, I think, that should go out.
Thank you, Dr. Wills, but I'm a little of the old school. Professor Rolf Richards, through the Caribbean Food and Nutrition Institute, had designed a 1200 Jamaican diet and 1500. It has Jamaican foods on it. Ackee and saltfish, curry goat, but the quantities, and bean soup, and I'm just wondering if we couldn't really, I have a copy, and it's so important that the Jamaicans like the Jamaican food. Stewed peas, curry goat, all those things are on it. And I think we need to, the Mediterranean diet is fine, but I think Jamaicans will stick more to their Jamaican. So if anything, I can give it, send a copy for you.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, I think that's a good point. And I think, the take-home message is not necessarily for us to start all going to Mediterranean restaurants, but just to learn the message of the benefits of reduced carbohydrates, and if we're using oil, the olive oil, you know, hasn't been shown to be of harm. We know the coconut oil is still very controversial, and we use a lot of coconut oil. I won't touch that. But as it relates to instituting the Jamaican foods, I think this is where the dietitians and the nutritionists are of utmost importance, because they know they're better at than us for certainly at advising patients on how to institute these guidelines using Jamaican foods.
Hi. So I just wanted to make some comments and kind of ask a question to you, right? Diet and lifestyle are really my passion. So first of all, I wanted to ask your opinion about the ketogenic diet, because it has been shown to show to give a lot much better glycemic control results in diabetic patients than even the Mediterranean. In terms of adapting the Mediterranean diet for our population, I think two things we need to focus on with the Mediterranean diet would be that the carbohydrates in the Mediterranean diet, as you rightfully said, they're about 50 to 55% in macronutrient profile, but they're much higher in fiber content than processed carbohydrates that you would get from, as you said, bread, crackers.
Excuse me, I don't mean to be rude, but we're really strapped for time. Okay. And that's why I asked for two quick questions.
Okay, so ketogenic diet, I wanted some information. And just to tie in the Mediterranean diet with what Doc was saying about the stress factors, that a big part of the Mediterranean diet instructions would actually be to have it in a family setting, which also helps with stress reduction in terms of diabetes control.
Yeah, so quickly, so the ketogenic diet, as you said, has been shown to be beneficial. And again, a large part of the ketogenic diet is the elimination of carbohydrates. So again, that's another message of the benefits of low carbs. And what was the other thing again? And stress, yes. Yeah. Okay, eliminating stress is important.
Thank you so much. Can we give both doctors, Young Martin and Wilks, a big round of applause?